Good evening. Thank you all for coming out tonight to hear Campbell McGrath. Yes, we are so excited to have Campbell here. I'm Helen Wallace, and I started this reading series here at the Dalí. This is our second season, and let me remind you, we skipped the month of March because of the Grand Prix. So as much as we'd love to see you, don't come then. But do come in April. We have Jane Hirschfield coming in April, and she'll be a real treat. So we'd love to see you back in April. In the interim, Rhonda Nelson, who's in our audience tonight, is going to be playing Frida Kahlo. Is that the best way to put it? Performing Frida Kahlo? How should I describe it, Rhonda? Impersonating.
Not even
channeling.
Channeling.
That's the word.
Based on her life and her art, and I'm going to have a four-piece band behind me doing improvisation.
And that is March 30th.
Yes, Thursday, yes. March 30th.
So I'm telling you now, since we're not meeting in March, but come if you can. Some of you probably had the pleasure of hearing Rhonda read here a few months ago.
It's
do
going
come.
To be here in the theater, same time. Same bat time, same bat channel. Right. Yeah. It's Thursday the 30th. The doors open at 6, and the performance starts at 6:30.
And I'm sure will be a really terrific event. I've seen Rhonda perform before. So, yeah, come if you can. I believe it's also February 24th and 25th at Softwater Clay, which is in the Warehouse Arts District. There is the fantastic Ekphrastic. And some of you may have been able to go to that last year, and it's a really cool event where writers have submitted work based off of some kind of creative artwork, usually either sculpture or a wall hanging, painting, any number of things, and then an actor performs the piece. So you get sort of a three-hit thing that evening. It's a lot of fun, and that, again, is at Softwater Clay, and it runs two evenings. You do have to buy tickets. I believe you get them online. If you go to either Softwater Clay's website or I think the Warehouse Art District's website, you can find out more information about that. I believe that's the 24th and 25th of February. So it's not all poetry, but there's poetry in the mix as well. So including some poets who've read here at the Dalí series. So again, thank you all for coming out. Hank is not able to be here tonight. He is at a wedding in California, so that's a pretty good excuse. Otherwise, he would be here. He would not miss Campbell McGrath. So as usual, I'm just going to read one poem, and then I will have the pleasure of introducing Campbell. So this is a poem I wrote for a very good friend of ours, really for the son of a very good friend of ours. And I think the only thing you'll recognize is a couple of lines by Robert Frost, an epigraph from Mending Wall that starts the poem, and then a couple lines from that poem that thread throughout. This is called Poem for Juan Pablo. And the epigraph from Frost goes like this. Before I'd build a wall, I'd ask to know what I was walling in or walling out. Born of love, here, like any born of love, his father's dreams tucked around his shoulders like a shield, his mother's smeared with guava on whole wheat, there in his Spider-Man lunchbox, he hugs it to his hip as he rides the yellow school bus toward a dream like any parent's dream. His mother's prayers stacked like red brick around his soul, everybody's soul. Something there is that doesn't love a wall. When you find one, Juan Pablo, and you will, they're everywhere. Aim your soccer ball and kick hard, kick high, kick wide. Practice, Juan Pablo, growing stronger. Joy as your guard, wonder your barefoot guide. Sing, Juan Pablo, sing loud, in any language, sweet on your tongue. The sun shakes its tune on all of us. And when the school day is over, your backpack dropped on the floor, your parents still practice English over frijoles as evening falls into night. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, though you, Juan Pablo with red and yellow Legos build a world of beautiful pieces. How careful you are with each one. The small plastic mother, the father, a casa azul, a green car, a world of tenuous light. You, Juan Pablo, so smart, your parents beaming beside you. Ten cuidado, they tell you, it is fragile. They fear any minute it might fall. Something there is that doesn't love a wall. There's no limit to the world this child could build, no limit to the wonder he's found. So many bright pieces, his world, no one could ever knock it down. Thank you. Thank you. I had the pleasure of hearing Campbell read, gosh, I think it's been over 20 years, for the first time at Eckerd. I think Peter Meinke had invited you to Eckerd. I know you've been there many times. He just knocked everybody over way back then. And he's continued to do it. He's the author of 10 books of poetry, including Spring Comes to Chicago, Florida Poems, 7 Notebooks, and most recently, XX, Poems for the 20th Century, published by Echo Press just in 2016, just last year. His books are not here tonight, but you can find them ideally, hopefully, at Haslam's, if not, at Amazon. So hope you can look for those. He's received many of America's major literary prizes for his work, including the Kingsley Tufte Award, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a MacArthur Fellowship, a USA Knight Fellowship, and a Witter-Bynner Fellowship from the Library of Congress. His poetry's appeared in The New Yorker, in Harper's, in The Atlantic, and on the op-ed page of The New York Times, as well as in scores of literary reviews and quarterlies. He's born in Chicago. He lives with his family in Miami Beach, and his wife Elizabeth is here tonight. We're so glad she could come as well. And he teaches at Florida International University, where he's the Philip and Patricia Frost Professor of Creative Writing. Please give a warm welcome to Campbell McGrath.
A small tech problem. Poetry and technology don't always go together perfectly. Helen, thank you so much. That is such a warm and generous introduction, and that was a beautiful poem, and a timely poem in so many ways, too. And did you have a Casa Azul in there as well? There was a kind of small Frida Kahlo nod even in the poem, kind of subtly tying our presence here in this museum together. I'm delighted to be here and to be reading. As I just told Helen a few moments ago, my mother is moving to St. Petersburg, in fact, from Central Florida, also non-coastal Central Florida, this very spring. So hopefully we'll be spending more time here, coming over from Miami. And so I'm going to read a bunch of poems. I know that food and sustenance were a kind of notion that underlay some of our some of this.
That's our loose theme for this year's series.
For this year's series, which is great. It's great to have a theme, because then as a reader with 10 books in the world, it gives me an arrow to shoot towards a target and say, how am I going to organize this reading? What am I thinking about? What do I want to talk to with these folks? So sustenance is a great notion. And I'll start with food, the most obvious way of thinking about sustenance, and move through maybe a kind of series of ways of thinking about it, read you poems, and then I know we'll hopefully have questions and have conversation with Helen. So this first poem is called The Orange. Gone to swim after walking the boys to school. Overcast morning, midweek, off-season, few souls to brave the warm, storm-tossed waves, not wild, but rough for this tranquil coast. Swimming now, in rhythm, arm over arm, let the ocean buoy the body and the legs work little. Wave overhead, crash and roll with it, breathe, stretch and build, windmill, climb the foam, breathe, breathe. Traveling downwind, I make good time and spot the marker by which I know to halt and forge my way ashore. Who am I to question the current? Surely this is peace abiding. Walking back along the beach, I mark the signs of erosion, bide the usual flotsam of seagrass and fan coral, afloat from somebody's fishing boat, crusted with sponge and barnacles, and then I find the orange. Single irradiant sphere on the sand, tide washed, glistening as if newborn, golden orb, miraculous fruit. In all that sweep of horizon, the only point of color. Cross-legged on my towel, I let the juice course and mingle with the film of salt on my lips and the sand in my beard as I steadily peel and eat it. Considering the ancient lineage of this fruit, the long history of its dispersal around the globe on currents of animal and human migration, and in light of the importance of the citrus industry to the state of Florida, I will not claim it was the best and sweetest orange in the world, though it was, O great salt water of eternity, O strange and bountiful orchard. Thanks. Thank you. And in keeping with this citrus tradition, the next poem is called The Key Lime. And this is a very, very, very short poem about a very, very small fruit that packs a lot of dynamic flavor into that small-sized organism, just like poetry packs so much verbal and linguistic and intellectual energy into the small spaces. The Key Lime. Curiously yellow hand grenade of flavor. Molotov cocktail for a revolution against the bland. That's it. That's the whole thing. And this is another poem. This is a poem I wrote a very long time ago. We've been in Florida like 24 years now, 23-ish years. I actually used to come down to Key West with my family at Christmas time sometimes when I was, 12 and 13 years old. I grew up really in the Northeast. And this is a poem called Hemingway Dines on Boiled Shrimp and Beer. I'm the original two-hearted brawler. I gnaw the scrawny heads from prawns, pummel those mute, translucent crustaceans, wingless hummingbirds, salt water spawned. As the Catalonians do, I eat the eyes at once. My brawny palms flatten their mainstays. I pop the shells with my thumbs, then crunch. Just watch me as I swagger and sprawl, spice mad and sated, then dabble in lager before I go strolling for stronger waters down to Sloppy Joe's. My stride as I stagger shivers the islands. My fingers troll 1,000 keys. My appetite shakes the rock of the nation. The force of my miction makes the mighty Gulf Stream. Miction is a synonym for urination, just for the record on that poem. I don't even know where I came up with that word. Why didn't I just say urination? That might have been so boring. So I'm starting us off in Florida. Here's another Florida poem with food and at its heart, although this poem moves elsewhere. And it's about just this time of year, in fact, when our Meyer lemon tree in our big pot in our front yard bears its great dozens of fruits, and Elizabeth makes marmalade out of them. That's the starting point for this poem. And it's called Sugar or Blood. In the kitchen, Elizabeth has been making marmalade with the luxurious crop of our lemon tree. And from my desk, I can almost taste the caramelizing essence of citrus rind and vanilla beans and burnt sugar. And I can hear the piano concerto by Mozart she is listening to, which sounds like a pavilion constructed from lemon-tinted panes of sugar glass. And the Zairean music I'm listening to is like a tessellated and betasseled tapestry thrown upon the floor of a nomad's tent. And the sands of the Sahara continue their migration into the time-worn grasslands of the Sahel, and the Virunga volcanoes comprise a fog-shouldered heaven to the last families of mountain gorillas awaking before dawn. Shy Herculean versions of ourselves, brothers from a simpler dream, luminous and transient as meteors. There will come no more into this world when we have killed the last of them. So many spools of golden sorrow to unwind, so much pathos to weave upon a loom of human agency, as if we were not ourselves baboons on the savanna, not jackals, not giraffes in our ungainliness. As if to desire the coat of a jaguar, the fur of a snow leopard, was not a form of worship, as raw ore minted and coined resembles the child's flattering imitation of a mastery it will never equal. Who would not be a great cat in the Amazon or the Hindu Kush? Even the greenish pelt of a river monkey, its iridescent aura, even our two human bodies shimmer with the weird atomic eclipse light of life. Talking to myself like this, in a blazon and an emblem, I realize I have never said plainly most of what I truly believe. I have shied from difficulty and misstated my deepest fears. I have not borne full witness to the suffering in the streets of the cities I love. I have not walked a picket line against the tyranny of greed. I have been wily and evasive, even on behalf of art. I have not praised the movies in tones equal to the rapture I have known there. I cannot remember King Lear. I did not finish Ulysses or even start on Proust. Even now, I seek diversion in the candy necklace of delight. Even now, I refuse to commit. Even now, I would walk among jaguars, wearing the skin of a jaguar, as if it were not necessary to declare my allegiance, as if I did not have to choose. Which will it be, sugar or blood?
Wow.
Thank you. So again, I was really happy to have this thematic notion of food sustenance to go back into my work. I've actually been compiling, I've written 10 books, and I've been compiling a kind of a manuscript to produce a new and selected, it's like a greatest hits album. Well, if it doesn't work right, it's like a greatest hits album. That's what I don't really want to do, is have a greatest hits album. I like writing poems because I like writing books that I think are really good books. And so if I've already written them, I don't know why to bring them back together unless I can make a really good book that is in some way different from how those poems first appeared. So I've been working hard on that. So I've been kind of, in other words, going back through my own work and sifting through it. So this gave me a way of thinking about it. So those poems had to do with food, at least at one level or another, thinking about it. And we're all from Florida. But here's some that now leave Florida and still have food somewhere at the heart of them. And this one is a prose poem. It's called Plums. And it's about plums, but it also plays with the famous poem by William Carlos Williams about sealing the plums and eating them from the refrigerator. Plums, which is called This Is Just to Say. That's what that poem's called, Plums. I'm sitting on a hill in Nebraska in morning sunlight, looking out across the valley of the Platte River. My car is parked far below in the lot behind the rest stop wigwam, beyond which runs the highway.
Beyond the highway, stitch marks of the railroad, the sandy channels and bars of the Platte, a slow, wide bend of cottonwood saplings metallic in the sun. Beyond the river, a hazy Cézanne-like geometry of earthy blues, greens, and browns fading at last into the distance. Barrel music rises up from the traffic on I-80, strings of long-haul truckers rolling west, rolling east, the great age of the automobile burning down before my eyes, a thing of colossal beauty and thoughtlessness. For lunch, in a paper bag, three ripe plums and a cold piece of chicken. It is not yet noon. My senses are alive to the warmth of the sun, the smell of the blood of the grass, the euphoria of the journey, the taste of fruit, fresh plums, succulent and juicy, especially the plums. So much depends upon the image. Chickens, asphodel, a numeral, a seashell, one white peony flanged with crimson, a chunk of black ore carried up from the heart of anthracite to be found by a child alongside the tracks like the vestige of a former life. What is it? Coal. A touchstone polished by age and handling, so familiar as to be a kind of fetish, a rabbit's foot worn down to bone, a talisman possessed of an entirely personal, associative, magical significance. Why do I still carry it, that moment in Nebraska? Was it the first time I'd been west? First time driving across the country? Was it the promise of open space, the joy of setting out, the unmistakable goodness of the land and the people, the first hint of connection with the deep wagon ruts of the dream, the living tissue through which the Valley of the Platte has channeled the Mormons and the 49ers, the Pawnee and the Union Pacific? This ribbon of highway beneath a sky alive with the smoke of our transit, the body of the past consumed by the engine of our perpetual restlessness. How am I to choose among these things? Who am I to speak for that younger version of myself atop a hill in Nebraska, bathed in morning light? I was there. I bore witness to that moment. I heard it pass, touched it, tasted its mysterious essence. I bear it with me even now, an amulet smooth as a fleshless fruit stone. Plums. I have stolen your image, William Carlos Williams. Forgive me, they were delicious, so sweet and so cold. So I did, you know, I stole his image, so. I had to, I guess, acknowledge it in the concluding moment of the poem. But we do steal each other's images. Here's another poem, another little prose poem, that's called Philadelphia. Late dinner at a dark cafe blocks from Rittenhouse Square. Iron pots of mussels and Belgian beer and a waiter eager to snag the check and clock out. Such are the summer pleasures of his work. Winding down to a glass of red wine, catching the windowed reflection of a girl as she passes, counting the take upon the bar, thick roll of ones and fives, palming the odd ten smooth against zinc and polished walnut, the comforting dinginess of American money, color of August weeds in a yard of rusting appliances, hard cash, its halo of authority, the hand's delight in its fricatives and gutturals, its growl, its purr, gruff demotic against the jargon of paychecks on automatic deposit with Social Security deductions and prepaid dental. Realism versus abstraction, a gallery of modest canvases, more landscapes than still lives, steeples of the old city with masts and spars, a vista of water meadows with fishermen hauling nets in the distance, women collecting shellfish in wicker panniers. It yields enough to sustain us all, after all, the ocean of the past. We've paid. The waiter pockets his final tip and throws down his apron and walks out into the warm night of dogs splashing in public fountains and couples on benches beneath blossoming trees, and soon enough we follow, arm in arm across the cobblestones, looking for a yellow cab to carry us into the future. So I'm going to read two more food-based poems and then move away to maybe other ideas of sustenance. And the first one's called Capitalist Poem Number 5. And it's really the very first, it's not the very first poem I wrote, which my mother has in like a, you know, a yearbook when I was 6 years old or something. And I was writing poems, in fact, in high school and in college. It's the first poem I wrote in graduate school where I kind of suddenly said, why don't I write about things I actually know something about and care about instead of writing the kinds of poems I was being told to write by professors? Like, that's not, you know, you're told to write a great poem, a sonnet about a painting in a gallery, which is a fine thing to do. In fact, it's good to do, but at the end of the day, it wasn't something that I knew deeply personally about. So I said, well, what do I know about? And for curious reasons, the answer was the 7-Eleven, you know, a convenience store, which is where, you know, from where I grew up in Washington, D.C., it was the only kind of store I could really walk to, like 4 or 5 blocks away. So I wrote this poem, Capitalist Poem Number 5. I was at the 7-Eleven. I ate a burrito. I drank a Slurpee. It was late after work, washing dishes. The burrito was good. I had another. I did it every day for a week. I did it every day for a month. To cook a burrito, you tear off the plastic wrapper. You push button number 3 on the microwave. Burritos are large, small, or medium. Red or green chili peppers, beef or bean or both. There are 7-Elevens all across the nation. On the way out, I bought a quart of beer for $1.39. I was aware of social injustice in only the vaguest possible way. And here's another poem I wrote that is maybe in some sense the same poem much later in my life. This poem is called Woe. Actually, it was originally called Capitalist Poem Number something or other, 48 or 47, because I've written a lot of them. But my editor didn't want me to call it Capitalist Poem. He said, I think we're done with the Capitalist Poems. Give me a little title. And my editor never tells me anything really like that. So and he's very smart and knows me. So I said, all right, you're right, I'll get rid of the title. So this poem's called Woe. W-O-E, not like whoa, good news. Consider the human capacity for suffering, our insatiable appetite for woe. I do not say this lightly, but the sandwiches at Subway suck. Foaming lettuce, mayo like rancid bear grease, meat the color of a dead dog's tongue. Yet they are consumed by the millions and by the tens of millions. So much for the food. The rest I must pass over in silence. So much for the food. Well, yes, in terms of tonight's reading, so much for the food also. So, sustenance. I believe that we all, of course, need food for sustenance, and I don't know that every single person on the planet needs art for sustenance, but I do personally feel that I need art for sustenance. I think it's, in fact, what art is for. And so I'm gonna switch and read to you, those were older poems. This is the book that came out this year. It's called XX Poems for the 20th Century, and it's a kind of documentary historical poetry project. It's 100 poem long sequence of one poem for every year of the 20th century written in the voice of, in the character of a different historical figure, many of them artists, such as Frida Kahlo, and that's what I'm gonna read first, in fact. I move in and out of different people's lives. They're not all a kind of persona poems written in a voice, but many of them are. So I wanted to start by reading a few artist-centric art poems, and this is a Frida Kahlo poem called, there's 3 Frida Kahlo poems in the book, actually. This is Frida Kahlo, self-portrait with hand mirror and retablo of Leon Trotsky, 1933. My canvas, my prickly cactus, my pickaxe, my accident, my bus ride, my all mixed up insides, my androgyny, my lost progeny, my petite bourgeoisie, my bloodworm, my calls, my sack of penny nails, my hammer and sickle, my tinsmith, my pictoglyphs, my disease, my pliancy, my splintered bones, my pelvis, my Coyoacan, my womb, my home, my white light, my blue house, my red, red flag, my workers' protest, my clenched fist, my amanuensis, my shark, my shadow, my heart of darkness, my lovers and letters, my his and my hers, my transfusions, my transformations, my testimony, my reflection, my being, my agony, my me, my me, my me. And this is Picasso. Thank you. I'd never written a poem like that before or made up that kind of voice or style, but one of the great challenges of this book and one of the pleasures of it was saying, well, I'm not Frida Kahlo, needless to say, and nor am I Picasso, nor am I even someone who I might be more closely historically related to. How do I assume their voice? What does it mean? How do I, and in this book, I tried to devise a kind of formal strategy within the poem that was different for each voice. If I was gonna be Matisse or if I was gonna be Frida Kahlo. With the exception of Pablo Picasso, whom I ended up writing a ton of poems about, I wrote like 25 Picasso poems, and only about 10 or 12 got in the book finally. And in his case, I wanted to do a different form every time his voice showed up because he was such a crazy, psychotic reinventor of himself and constantly like running roughshod over the world. So here's a little Picasso poem, Picasso, 1934. Spain and women, they bleed, they argue and protest. They stink of camphor and the sea. Yet I cannot live beyond their shadows. I cannot create my art without their elemental ore. I quarry them, I gore them, I rage against their flags and lances. I am the bull, certainly I am the bull, but I am also the matador. Thank you. I'm going to read one more art-based poem. This is Matisse, and this is 1923, when he was living in the south of France, which he did for a long time. This city resembles the bored, immodest women I paint by the dozens, louche houris in harem pants, baring their breasts to the Mediterranean wind. I live now on a rectangular canvas stretched between the castle and the harbor, between the tawdry glamour of the gamblers risking fortunes at the casino and the crosshatchings of the old quarter where the niçoises hang laundry and filigreed cages for parakeets along a web of alleyways congested as a Moroccan souk. Alone with the goldfish in my studio, how is it I fail again in my intention to visit my family in Paris? Seasons becoming years, thinking only of painting, standing at the window in my striped work pajamas, walking the streets in sabots through unfelt snow, chained to the ranks of my odalisques. My birthday passes unnoticed. To my children, I become inscrutable, unreachable. I am 53. Last night, I came across the orderly chaos of a movie being filmed, the director shouting through his megaphone at 1 a.m., while firemen turned their hoses to a cold drizzle falling on camels and horses and robed sheiks, all the exotic machinery of their masquerade, the strange illusory illumination of the cinema, like the light of our world seen through the heavy glass of a fishbowl. Only in retrospect can the life of the artist be understood for what it is. Only in the 1,001 nights of his seduction by the muse and her lush confabulations. My father was a seed merchant in Flanders. My people have lived in that unlovely precinct for centuries. From treeless fields, I have come to this place of salt-stained silk and inarticulable sadness. From the labor of shopkeepers and tradesmen, from the loom toil of village weavers, from grim rectitude, from thrift and vigilance, from oyster shell to crimson and topaz, from ashen bistre to sumptuary light. From the quietude of the Middle Ages, I awoke as a flight of arrows above the plain, as a file of crows battling northern squalls, from dream to dream, unending. Love sustains us. I think that's kind of maybe obvious, but worth stating. Here's two poems with love as the form of sustenance. This first one's called The Human Heart. We construct it from tin and ambergris and clay, ochre, graph paper, a funnel of ghosts, whirlpool in a downspout full of midsummer rain. It is, for all its freedom and obstinance, an artifact of human agency in its maverick intricacy, its chaos reflected in earthly circumstance, its appetites mirrored by a hungry world like the lights of the casino in the coyote's eye. Old as the odor of almonds in the hills around Solano, filigreed and chanceled with flavor of blood oranges, fashioned from moonlight, yarn, nacre, cordite, shaped and assembled valve by valve, flange by flange, and finished with the carnal fire of interstellar dust. We build the human heart and lock it in its chest and hope that what we have made can save us. And this is a poem, as I said, most of the poems in this 20th century book are an individual voice speaking out of an individual year, individual moment in time. But in order to tell the story more completely, I had to do some moments where I kind of became like a newsreel, where I ran through a bunch of information about a period of time. And those poems were organized around the theme of a ticking clock. There's a ticking clock, there's an atomic clock, there's various clocks throughout the century. And the last one of those poems is called Digital Clocks. And it's 1992, which is the year our oldest son was born. About many things, but foremost among them, about how time changes utterly when you bring children into the world. And I'm really reminded to read this poem because I have a number of my former grad students are at the stage in life where they're having babies, which is great because we get to be kind of surrogate aunts and uncles to these babies. And I just got an email like last week, like, been reading Digital Clocks, thanks. And this was a grad student who's actually a lovely guy who grew up in Key West, and they had twins as their first kids. I was like, oh boy. You know, check back in a couple of years when you guys have time to think. So this poem's called Digital Clocks, 1992. It kind of catalogs a little bit about what's going on in that year and the world we have. Oh! That is perfect timing.
Yeah, go.
So again, these poems kind of have, you know, in general, they've cataloged the year of 1905, 1942. This one is obviously more modern times. It gives us some information. It moves on. And then again, it's a year, I say, my son Sam was born. Digital Clocks, 1992. Nothing is ticking. The clocks are cheap electronic displays flashing disarticulated red numerals in the darkness. The World Wide Web is an egg-slick hatchling, a wobbly-legged colt. Hyperlink is not part of the jargon. Spam is still canned meat. Reality television is not yet a buzzword. The joys and sorrows of the Kardashians remain entirely their own. Everything is digital, but the future will be virtual. The future will be live-streamed, crowdsourced, fully interactive. Bill Clinton becomes president. The Cold War peters out. The European Union is founded to polite applause. Rigoberto Menchú wins the Nobel Peace Prize. The AIDS quilt is unveiled. McDonald's opens in Beijing. The borough of Centralia, Pennsylvania is condemned and seized by eminent domain. Fires beneath the town will burn, it is estimated, for another 250 years. The century is long in the tooth. The century is closing up shop, bringing down the curtain, heading for the exits. Francis Bacon dies. John Cage and Lawrence Welk die. Freddie Mercury has decamped. Miles Davis has laid down his horn. Bruto Bettelheim, Jiang Qing, Martha Graham, Dr. Seuss, Frank Capra, Ava Gardner, and Curtis LeMay are gone. On a beautiful spring day in Chicago, Sam McGrath is born, and history halts in its tracks. No, history remains blind to the astonishing arrival of this red-haired infant with the deeply wrinkled aspect of a wise and ancient aunt. But my own life, so profoundly engaged with the culture decouples in that instant from its onrushing locomotive. Time alters, or I do. I let go of the guide rope, drop the century's ticker tape lifeline, and drift into a still pool beyond the pull of historical circumstance. Exhaustion and exultation. What else happened in 1992? What were the hit songs, the movies? It's all recoverable. The data is in the cloud. We have entered the information age. But can you turn back a clock that lacks the metaphor of hands? What else has been lost with the watchmaker's tools, if not the idea of time as continuum, time as a coiled spring? Earth orbits the sun, but what are hours? Do minutes exist if we do not hear them tick? A century is a measuring stick, a heuristic, but where is the glory in a love supreme compared with an instant of bird-trilled infant babble? Against a scraped knee, what matters the tragedy of Verdun? Century of infant teeth and artificial hearts, century of triumphalism and colostrum. And what else? What else happened that year we wove a swallow's nest of baby blankets and teething rings around ourselves? One Sunday, we took Sam to visit his great-grandmother, Jane, in a room smelling of medicine and sugar cookies, where, with Sam in her lap, she recalled with vivid immediacy an event from her own childhood. She was raised in towns across the north woods of Wisconsin, her father a foreman following the lumberjacks from mill to mill, and one night the forest caught fire, the mill town engulfed, Jane's family racing to escape in a horse-drawn wagon, swaddled in wet rugs against a storm of sparks and embers. It was as visceral to her as if it had happened yesterday. The smell of the dank wool, pine trees bursting into flame. You could see her descend within herself to that place, that moment, and draw it forth like water from a well. You could feel history crowding the room with its shadows, history embodied in the child of a horse-drawn past and the child of a technologically unimaginable future, together in a small apartment in a Midwestern suburb, together in the only place we ever inhabit, the present tense, the human instant. I can still feel it right now. It's 2016, but I'm there with Jane and the world she summoned. It's 1903, it's 1992. I'm immersed in it like lava, alive in the pulse of it, the gyre and genuflection of it. What is memory but the instantiation of time within us? What is history but a chorus of ghosts? What is the past but that great burning, that forest of ashes, the sound of horses running through the darkness?
Wow.
Thank you.
I'm going to read. I'm going to read one more poem, and I tend to write poems about traveling and just all over the country. So I usually have a poem very local to where I am. So this is one I wanted to read. Of course, I live in South Florida, so it's not that surprising. But this is a poem called "The Gulf," and we used to go and spend time not far away in near Englewood, Englewood Beach, Manasota Key, which is often which is part of Englewood Beach or whichever. This is a poem really about sustenance. It's about nature, memory, the world, and how just those things interact to provide us, you know, lifelines into and out of ourselves and our present worries and concerns sometimes. So this is called "The Gulf." Floating in the Gulf on a hot June day, listening to the seashells sing, eyes open, I watch their migrations, their seismic shifts and tidal seizures as I am seized and lifted, lulled and hushed and serenaded. Eyes closed, I drift amid their resonant sibilance, soft hiss and crackle in the tide wash, ubiquitous underwater, a buzz like static or static electricity, but not mechanical, organic and musical, metallic as casino muzak. Piles of change raked together, a handful of pennies down a child's slide. Eyes open, I see them rise as one with the water, climbing the ridge with the incoming surge, and then, released, called back, slide slowly down the face of their calcified escarpment. The small rippling waves butt up against and topple over, flop, whoosh. A fine wash of shells and shell bits and shards, a slurry of coquinas and scallops and sunrays, coral chunks, tubes and frills, the volute whorls of eroded whelks, a mass of flinty chips and nacreous wafers singing as it descends. Like mermaids singing, but not a song. Stranger and more varied, more richly textured, many-timbered. Gregorian hymns or aboriginal chanting, the music of pygmies in a forest clearing, complex, symphonic, indecipherable, but not human, elemental, like rain, bands of tropical rain approaching from the jungle, sweeping the tile veranda, the sheet metal roof, against the slats of the louvered window and across the floor of stormlight and coffee-flavored dust, but not liquid mineral, mountains of shattered porcelain, broken bottles en route to the furnace, but not glass and not rain and not even a rain of glass. Ice, the day after the ice storm, when the sun peeks out and wind comes off the lake, and what has so beautifully jeweled the trees all morning breaks loose in a sequence of tumbling cascades, chiming like tumbrils and lost castanets, falling upon snow-covered cars and encrusted fences, discarded Christmas trees piled up in the alley, smelling of wet balsam, string and plastic in their hair, and forgotten tinsel, and every needle encased in a fine translucent sheet of ice. And as I reach to touch them with my fingers, they brush the sand, and my knees bump the bottom, and I am called back with a start, alien, suspended, wholly conceived within that other music, body in the water like the water in the flesh and the liquid in the crystal and the crystal in the snowflake and the mind within the body like the branch within its skin of ice. Eyes open, eyes closed, floating in the gulf, listening to seashells, thinking of the Christmas trees in the back alleys of Chicago.
Wow.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Helen.
Wow. Your poems just took us so many places. You know, writing long poems is sometimes really hard to do because I'm sure some of you have read some yourself. Sometimes they can kind of fall flat, and Campbell has a way of doing it that just keeps us with them. So I know that'll be one question I want to discuss is just how you do that. I think it's tough. I think it's, you know, I mean, we could listen to you all night.
Well, yeah, maybe, but...
I do want to get questions from the audience first, though, and then I think I'm going to... Usually I'm up here, but I think tonight I'm just going to stay
here. I think we can talk easily through this space. Yeah,
okay.
I think we're just fine.
And, yeah, this mic, I think, is meant to stay here, right? Yeah, okay. But speak up. If you can't hear us, we'll talk louder. Questions from you all for Campbell.
Anybody? Anything?
I have one. Helen always talks about how she urges her students to use concrete images in poetry,
mm-hmm.
and you are the an example beyond any I've ever heard or read for the use of those concrete images. So wondering, do you ever feel yourself drifting toward abstraction instead of concrete images? It's so remarkable how dense your poetry is.
I mean, concrete imagery is the essence of my poetry. There's no two ways about it. There are other ways of thinking about poetry. You know, I'll have conversations with another poet. Like, one of my very favorite poets is Lee Young Lee, who's he's an absolutely wonderful poet and is a kind of very cosmic and abstract poet. Mm-hmm. And I'll say, I don't understand how you write, you know, how come I can't get more of that, you know, that stuff in my poem? He's like, well, I can't get 7-Elevens in my poem. You know, I wish I could. I'm like, well, you know, I guess that's a difference. So my poetry, for whatever reason, I don't have a strategy for how I rose at it. It has always been about, I mean, I guess I use this word often as like documentary. I believe that poetry is a great documentary medium. It's not what most people take poetry to be for, or to be, you know, what they use it for at least. But I think it's an amazing way of talking about the real world that I inhabit, that I walk through, that I see, and trying to make sense of that world, you know, which often means I mean, the poems I read tonight are very image-centered. I'm just, you know, thinking of it now. I mean, several of those poems, like that poem, Plums, and that last poem, The Gulf, is just about floating in, like, 6 inches of water, listening to those seashells as they go back and forth, and looking at them and trying to say, but how do I describe that? What is that sound? Is it this or that? It's kind of like, you know, Muzak, but no. It's kind of mechanical, but no. It's not this, and then... Oh, maybe the thing it most reminds me of is that ice cascading off of things. And it's just, so that whole poem is about a zeroing in on how do I describe what that sound, you know, and that's a sonic image more than even a visual image, which is the first thing we think of. So this is not, it's a great thing to tell your students, and I'm telling them constantly, concrete images create a believable world that you then share with the reader. So then whatever you do next, the reader believes in this world you've created. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it, again, Lee Young, as we just said, is a great poet, and it's not—it's very rare that you concretely attach to his poem. So there's a lot of ways of going about it.
Yeah, so some poets can pull it off. But I would argue that with your poems, and some of them become sort of list poems, where you're listing one image after another and showing us all the stuff of the world as you go. But then, I've never read any of your poems and felt like they were strictly descriptive. Because you do... You build on this the aggregate of images, and then you take it a step further with a sort of narrative. I hate to say narrative summary, but you put in enough reflection to balance that off. And at that point, I think it just works so perfectly because we're all right there with you in that poem. I mean, that's what the use of the senses. You know, that's what it does for us. It gets our readers inside the poem with us, and I think you're just a master at that.
Well, I mean, there's not that many things we all share universally, but like the fact that we are all human beings alive on planet Earth, existing in time. That sounds very cosmic, right? But the thing is, we don't ever think of ourselves that way. Nobody ever conceives themselves as a human being existing in time, but that's what we are. So strangely, I think the only way to make that grand universal conclusion feel real is by pointing out the specific, but we all have hands, so we all can touch a thing and feel it. We all see and hear. So even though I may never have felt the moment described by another poet, if it feels real in that person's human existence, I can immediately, you know, empathically say, oh, wow, that's another human being doing a thing in time. I mean, that's why poems, I think, more than most art forms or other literary forms, really speak across time. I mean, some of my favorite poets are Basho and Rilke and Sappho. You can read Sappho's poems. Those little tiny fragmented moments feel so totally alive and because you feel like there was a human being there who saw that and felt that. That's not that you can't do that in a novel or anything else, but poetry tends to be about that moment.
Crystallize some of that. Yeah. Good. Other questions? Yes. Is that Sonia?
Yeah.
Hi, Sonia.
So I was wondering about the genesis behind the idea of the XX?
Yeah.
That book, like where did that come from, and how did you decide, one poem per year?
Right.
It's a great idea. Yeah.
Well, again, it kind of probably goes back to what we were talking about, which is that I am a documentary poet in that, in some sense we create art out of our own lives. We have imaginations too, but our own life, is something we start with. So at a certain point, when you've written a bunch of poems, you get tired about writing about your own experience and say, I wonder what Frida Kahlo's experience was like, or this person here. And I hadn't done that until my eighth book is a book-length narrative poem about a guy who was on the Lewis and Clark expedition, whose name was George Shannon. He was the youngest guy, an 18-year-old kid, on the Lewis and Clark expedition. And while that expedition was going up the Missouri River, he got lost and wandered alone for 16 days in what's now Nebraska and South Dakota. And I had always been struck by this tiny little historical detail, and one time I just started writing this guy's story. And that was really interesting and liberating. I really like history. I would be a historian if I couldn't be a poet, kind of. But writing as George Shannon, what do I know about a 18-year-old kid born in, the 1790s in the frontier, which was then in Pennsylvania. But it turns out, if you know what a human being is like, you can imagine your way into George Shannon. You have to do a lot of research, you have to go and explore and read books and stuff. But it was very interesting. So anyway, having written that book, I said to myself, I want to try that again, But instead of one person's voice telling a story, I want to be like a symphony, a lot of voices. What story could a lot of voices tell? Mm-hmm. For unknown reasons, the entire 20th century popped in my head as a good project. And I mean, it was partly was the logic. You know, I like the simplicity of 100. You know, there was that made sense to me, and it also gave me some kind of goal posts. Like, okay, one per year. So you have to come up with something for 1912 and something for 1971, and so you could kind of fill in the grid. I mean, I wrote it over many years. Seven, eight, 9 years, you know. I mean, so at first I wasn't sure I'd really get the whole project done. Maybe it would just become this or the, you know, just some poems. But as I kept going, I was like, well, you know, once I got to like 40 or 50, I said, I think I'll get this finished, why not? You know, I mean, because there's no rush. It takes another 5 years, so what? Poetry is not a, you know, fast-moving art form, and it's not, mm-hmm. there's no marketplace for it, so you don't have to worry about the market. I mean, it is the pressures of the marketplace that make so many things in our lives seem really urgent and needed and necessary and, like, you know, time-bound. But poetry is free of those constraints. So I just started in. I started doing it. I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed being some people. Other people that I wanted to write about, I could never get their voice down very well. So, you know, it was very interesting. It was like a real learning experience. And I was just, I really enjoyed, you know, years worth of piling up big biographies and history books and plowing my way through them and just trying to, you know, get another piece of the puzzle filled in.
And I know in a lot of your longest poems, you do, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but you don't necessarily force yourself to stick to the same structure for every segment of the poem. You might play around, and part of it could be a prose poem, and part of it is something where you might be doing something in a different sort of voice. So you use almost the infrastructure of the longer narrative, but then you mm-hmm. let yourself play within that, which I mm-hmm. think is really an interesting way of keeping it so interesting for the reader.
Yeah, part of that is
Can you talk a little bit more about that? Yeah. I'm sure you can describe it a lot.
I'm very impatient, you know? Like, I lose interest in things pretty quickly. Like, if I've already written a poem like X, I don't really want to write another one, even though maybe I should, you know? But so I kind of, that's why each book I try to make a different kind of project. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, part of this is just setting ambitions that you're not sure, like William Faulkner defined, you know, people say, like, you know, who's the great American novelist? Was it this? Was it that? And Faulkner always said, no, it was Moby Dick. Because, you know, it's a kind of colossal failure. I mean, really, it's a book of genius, but it kind of also makes no sense at all and is really cockamamie and crazy. But Faulkner said, if you don't fail, you haven't pushed yourself far enough.
Interesting.
I mean, it's kind of failure that defines, you know, genius or excellence or really ambition. That, like, you know, Faulkner was kind of putting down Hemingway. It was part of what he was doing. Like, you know, Hemingway, yeah, he knew what he could do, so he did it. What you've got to do is something that you can't do, because only when you get to where you have failed have you actually gotten to the end of what you can do and pushed yourself. I think that's really true. And so I keep trying to do it. That's why this book set such a giant agenda. And the first time I did that was in my third book, which is Spring Comes to Chicago, where I wrote a book. It's a book-length poem, although it's not the whole book. It's called the Bob Hope poem, like a book-length poem about Bob Hope. That's a crazy idea. And it's really about People magazine and about the city of Chicago, and it's about capitalism, and it's about American culture, and it's all woven together. And in that, too, it's like little haiku-like pieces, mm-hmm. big, long, discursive pieces, lots of quotes from people just thrown in there. It's like a giant hodgepodge. It's like, well, that's all in my mind. Why shouldn't I put it in the poem? I mean, shouldn't the poem reflect your mind and what you're thinking and what you're doing? Shouldn't you just try to get it all in there? But there's a lot to be said for actually rigor and, like, sticking with a form. I'm just not too great at it. as the poem expands.
Yeah.
I mean, you can, you know, a sonnet needs to be a sonnet. A sonnet is, you know, it's a frame of a certain size. Mm-hmm. So you need to have if you're going to write a sonnet, it's like painting a portrait. You need to have a portrait should be a picture of a person. It should fit in that size frame. Sonnet, likewise. Sometimes sonnets are trying to take on too much, so they fail. Sometimes there's not really enough to even fill the frame. But if you're trying to write a long poem, whether that's 4 pages or like if it's 80 pages, you need a giant subject and even more than one subject. You need more things. And then I think it's okay to then, you know, shift voices, shift forms, and kind of weave things together. I think, like, symphonically, the way a symphony mixes different themes, components, elements, instruments, tempos, and it somehow at the end still feels like a whole.
And you come back sometimes to some of your same ideas, of your same images, and they almost become sort of infrastructure for your poem.
Just like in a symphony, how there's, you know, if you heard that little theme or little melody early on, it's gonna come back, and you don't feel, in fact, you don't really feel satisfied.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not a, you know, you hear those things and you say, oh, this, or again, it's very important in poems to have closure, which is this strange word, because like, but like everything ends, but not everything has closure. Like a car alarm makes a lot of noise and then suddenly it stops, but there's no closure to that. It just stops. But that symphony, when it comes to an end, you say, aha, that's closure, when those last things sing. That ended, and it ended in a way that you feel a sense of, yes, a thing has been completed, the right thing has been accomplished. So again, in longer poems, I try to, I feel like, not that I know anything about classical music or symphonies in particular, by the way, but that notion of what a symphony does is what I'm trying to do. Mm-hmm. But again, I love writing haiku, which is the tiniest and smallest of forms too, you know? And those, you certainly need to stick rigorously to just that one instant, that one image, that one perception.
Because if you've seen Campbell's poems on the page, often they are the long line, kind of Whitman-esque structure, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
Other questions from you all? Anybody?
Yes, right in the back. I can't hardly see.
So I guess poetry, like any other art, can be taken pretty seriously, especially if you're entrenched in the community. So I just wanted your thoughts on the role of wit or humor in poetry.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed some of that in your...
I think you guys, was the last people you had here was David and Barbara?
Yeah.
I mean, David, and, you know, David Kirby and Barbara Hamby are from Tallahassee, who read here a month or two ago, are hysterically funny,
mm-hmm.
both of them. They both, in very different ways, they bring wit. You know, mm-hmm. David through kind of narrative and voice, and Barbara through all the incredible language, mm-hmm. play, and energy.
And a lot of pop culture, all
and they're full
in,
of pop culture,
like
exactly, right. I agree that in when I was, you know, training to be a poet in the 1980s and 90s, it was bad to be funny. That was bad. You had to be very serious. Mm-hmm. Poetry was very self-important and very serious.
Mm-hmm.
Which I was like, I'm not sure I really believe that. I mean, why? Again, it's like, why would I rule out part of my life? I feel like in the end of the day, I want my poems to reflect how I am, what I'm thinking, what I am. And I just tend to find the world hysterically funny, kind of, especially when it's really tragic and dark, in a strange way. Again, this all goes back, by the way, to Aristotle, who, when he was making up the rules, said that tragedy was the important genre and comedy was the lesser genre. No, everybody in the argument, like when you say, well, why is comedy the lesser genre? They always go right back to Aristotle.
Mm-hmm.
Like, look at who's going to win the Academy Award. Whatever it's going to be, it's not going to be a comedy movie. It's always something serious and urgent and dramatic. This goes back to Aristotle. It's a mistake. But there's a quote from an Irish poet that says, tragedy is only underdeveloped comedy.
Mm-hmm. Mm. There you go.
If you really, really push through the tragic thought process, you get to where the comedy, and maybe perhaps mm-hmm. a dark kind of comedy lives.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a wonderful quote, which is now attributed to Carol Burnett, but I believe it was originally said by Buster Keaton, and that is, comedy is tragedy plus time.
Well, I've seen that quote too. Yeah, it's very much the same thought. That Irish quote was by Patrick, what's that guy's name? The Statues by the Canal. Can't remember his name off the top of my head. Famous Irish poet.
Mm.
But, you know, so I believe in comedy. I think life's funny. Many things are funny. But is everything funny? No. So, you know, I have very serious poems and I have very, very comic poems. And most often, those registers kind of mix. That'd be most typical for me.
Other questions? Yes.
I see his hand in there.
Hi, Helen.
You said Justin.
Campbell,
hey,
Justin.
Hey.
Thanks for coming out and reading tonight.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
Mentioned having taught a lot of grad students for many years. In your teaching and in your reading, who are some poets that you struggle with, or some poets that challenge you? Either to sort of teach or to...
Poets that challenge me? Well, I don't teach them if they challenge me. That's not really true. I actually love teaching things that I don't quite understand because then the students will explain them to me. you know, I'll present it out there and say, I think this is about this, and then they'll say, no, I'm like, that's what I meant. Yes. That's what we were pushing at. You know, things I partially understand, you know, if you're talking about smart graduate students, by the end of it, they really bring this energy and intelligence to it, and it really does clarify things for me. I mean, there's, you know, my comfort zone as a poet, you know, comes out of Walt Whitman, comes out of a big discursive American voice documenting the world, talking about American society and culture and landscape. That's just Whitman's voice that kind of spoke to me and in a way gave me permission to write poetry in the way I do. So, you know, the great alternative figure, the mother-father figure is Emily Dickinson. Mm-hmm. But because I can naturally kind of be like Whitman, I want to be like Dickinson. That's what I work at, because it doesn't come easily to me. You know, I'm like, I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to be as sly and compressed and secretive and urgent as her poems are. You know, her poems speak in a mysterious voice to some other, which is it God? Is it a lover? Who is that person? Whereas Whitman speak, you know, broadly to we the people or whomever. So I'm always, once I kind of got, you know, once I first established myself in the vein I was good at, said, but I want to do the other stuff. How do those guys do that? You know, how does that person achieve that amazing thing? And that's what I keep working at, is things that I can't quite do or can't figure out. Mm-hmm. And boy, these days American poetry is so diverse and fragmented and all over the place that there are tons of things going on in American poetry that I do not claim to understand. I'm teaching a graduate seminar on contemporary American poetry that I hadn't taught before, so I had to make up a whole new syllabus and really just like say, what am I going to teach out of all these dozens and hundreds of good poets and books out there? What am I going to make sense of? Part of it is things I know that I care about and love, but part is like, I don't understand this. This is a big thing going on in poetry. There's dozens of people doing this. Here are some of the texts. Let's read them and see if we can make sense of them.
Can you give a couple examples of what, do you mean, are you talking about language poetry?
Well,
or?
Yeah, I mean, just in general, like American poetry, you know, the right wing of American poetry is the traditional poets who still even write in verse mm-hmm. and meter and teach at Yale University and are the conservative, formal-based thing. And some of them are very good poets. Some of them were my teachers in graduate school. But that's, you know, the tradition is important, and they're a little bit suspicious of anything else. And the left wing is this experimental bunch of poets that, you know, kind of sprang out of Gertrude Stein's head, in a way, and have carried on for 100 years in various channels. There are great poets in that tradition, like George Opin in particular, a poet I really love. I mean, in a way, William Carlos Williams is part of that tradition, mm-hmm. although earlier on it has more of a different sensibility. But certainly since like the 1970s or 80s, there's been this whole very empowered branch of American poetry. Language poetry is one name for it, all sorts of kind of deconstructive. It's heavily influenced by, you know, French literary and critical theories of the 70s and 80s by Lacan and Jacques Derrida. Mm. And it basically turns poetry into a form of critical, deconstructive Derrida imitations. Mm-hmm. And very little of it strikes me as great. Some of it seems good. Occasionally I find a book that's really interesting. So, you know, but it's, if you were, you know, I'm talking about training, talking about graduate students who are 24 or 25 years old, they need to understand that poetry in that world because it's a big part of the poetry world they're trying to enter. You need to be able to engage with it and kind of, you can't just say, I don't get it or I don't like it. That's so fun. It's a way of, yeah. You know, but so together we're hopefully going to work through some of these texts and they'll tell me how to think about them.
Yeah.
I mean, here's a particular book. This book won the National Book Award just this year, and I'm like, who the heck is that person? Daniel Borzutsky. Mm. I finally got the book just like a week ago. It's called, I can't remember what it's called. It's astonishing. I'm not actually sure I'd even call it poetry exactly. Mm. I mean, it's kind of like Kafka's Parables as written by Roberto Bolaño, if that means anything. They're really crazy, intense, brilliant, and like all over the place. They don't much resemble poetry in any way, shape, or form. It's a kind of more like a kind of postmodern fiction. Mm-hmm. But it's, so it's an astonishing book. But you know, so again, to fit that into my framework of what a poem mm-hmm. is or isn't, even though I have a very mm-hmm. expansive one, is a little tricky.
I'm reminded of Andre Kudrusko, who's been here, uh-huh. and mm-hmm. Some of you all may have heard him speak here at the Dalí, and of course he was very influenced by, very influenced by Surreal and
right.
Surrealism, so he's a perfect person yeah. to speak here at the Dalí.
Absolutely.
But Dadaism, and yeah.
And he also crosses that boundary from kind of postmodern, you know,
yes.
you know, he poems and to nonfiction to fiction, that all there's a middle realm. Well, that also points out the fact that the notion of these labels in art are often misguided. The notion that one thing is a prose poem and one thing is a short story, well, to be honest, most of the time there really could be both, and it's just a matter of which label you want to affix to it. I mean, a sonnet is a poem and a novel is a novel, but there's a whole lot of writing that's in a middle ground that partakes of the strengths of fiction and the strengths of poetry, intermixes them, finds ways of making
absolutely
great art.
And I love that, the hybrid genres.
I think they're really, they're very exciting places in art. It's like, you know, it's like we were just listening to this book on the drive over here today from Miami about the history of the cod. You know, it's a book that's out by Mark Kurlansky. It's been out for a while. It's History of the Codfish. This may sound boring. It's very interesting. And the cod, you know, the cod, which is the history. By the way, the next book I'm writing is a history book about the North Atlantic. A history / poetry, maybe poetry in the form of history, as this book is. Because, I mean, again, we live in Miami Beach. We're watching the sea rise up and swallow our little island. Every summer we go up to New Jersey, where we live on another barrier island and swim in the Atlantic Ocean. And my ancestors, my grandparents came from Ireland, so there's a kind of... The Atlantic as a cultural basin, as a place that both unites and separates the old world and the new, and as an ecological concern. Anyway, so the codfish is very important to the history of the North Atlantic. And as he said in this book, where the codfish lived is where the Gulf Stream touches the polar currents, where two complicated currents come together, and, you know, life is spawned and the codfish lived there. And it's a bit of a leap, but that analogy to art, where artistic practices and forms come together, there's exciting territory to explore.
Yeah, I think so too, yeah. And I was just reminded, Lori Roy is with us in the audience. Thank you for coming, Lori, the wonderful fiction writer who's here, so yeah. You know, I was thinking about the fact that so much of your work is sort of documentary, and you're capturing the world as we know it now, which is tumultuous at best, with, you know, all kinds of stuff going on. And I'm wondering how that's affecting how in your work do you absorb all the various currents going on in some of the most politically tumultuous times. Does that question even make sense? But
yeah, sure.
I'm interested in specifically in because it's getting a lot of attention. Mm-hmm. What you see as the role of truth, whether you see it as emotional truth.
Right.
We've all heard that phrase. That maybe one of my favorite quotes is from Toni Morrison. There's a difference between fact and the imagination, but it takes a little of both to get to the truth. I love that. And many writers will make a case for the emotional truth being what's most important in our writing. So anyway, would you mind talking about that a little bit with respect to your poetry?
Sure. Well, I mean, first of all, in terms of American poetry, boy, there's a ton of political poetry being written. This goes back, I mean, 5-8 years pre, you know, the current election cycle. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was already happening. Very much about identity. That could be about race, about gender, just about identity and a kind of sense of how individuals fit into the communality of American society, which again, 5 years ago was one kind of conversation, and now is a much more confrontational and complicated conversation, you know, as of, you know, from the last year and through the present moment. But there are a ton of young poets, I mean, poets in their 20s and 30s, publishing books all the time, very, you know, deeply, immediately engaged with that, very powerful. Am I doing that? No.
Would you call them poets of witness or in the Carolyn Forshays?
I would say poets of identity. Really, first. But witness is part of that, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, there are, you know, there's just tons of poems about, basically, you know, about...
identity, yeah.
Mm-hmm. About Black Lives Matter. I mean, I can't tell you how many poems I've read in the last year, you know, citing the names of so many of the guys shot in inner cities and stuff. This is just like where young poets are really living, investing their time and energy right now. Mm. Some of them super powerfully. I'm always asking again. I'm asking my students, which one of these guys is really good, or what should I look at, what should I read, and trying to draw, you know, find out.
So many poets.
I'm not in my now, because just because I'm kind of an old person, I think, is why I'm not really doing that. I mean, I'm kind of surfing these longer currents of history and thought. That's just where my mind is right now. Again, it's this Atlantic Ocean project, which is about. I mean, another thing happening right now is Atlantic Ocean rising up to swallow us all. It's true on your side of Florida as just much as mine, but there's so much less seeming urgency in the way we think about that, because it's this long, giant process that's hard to get our mind around, whereas immediate social issues kind of have a different feel. Mm-hmm. So I think that I'm investing my time and energy there, but that it's powerful. You know, people write poems at first out of the passions they feel at the moment, and so many young people especially politics it feels incredibly urgent to them. Mm-hmm. So it's I even hear myself reading the poems. Some of them are apolitical, and then the politics that comes in is, you know, my own version of it. Mm-hmm. Like, why did we kill all the animals? That probably wasn't a good decision, but, you know,
somebody
I don't know.
Famous, I can't remember, said just the act of writing a poem is actually a political act of any poem. Putting the pen
I
to paper.
I think creating art.
I'm still mulling that one over, but yeah.
Oh no, but the truth. That was the part you said too. Mm-hmm. Truth is very complicated. Truth's complicated in art because, like, in nonfiction, we had this issue of like, oh, this person writes a memoir. It turns out, well, I'd have made it all up. Mm-hmm. That exploded in the last 5 or 10 years, mm-hmm. and suddenly made people say, wait a minute, mm-hmm. what is
million
that?
Million little pieces. Yeah.
How is a book called nonfiction able to be full of falsehoods, and that was a complication. Here's what I think about poetry. Because poetry doesn't have, poetry doesn't, you're not beholden to any master when you write a poem. You know, when you create any artwork, I suppose you're not beholden to any master, but the master that most things are beholden to is the marketplace. Whatever you're doing, there's a money-driven imperative. I think that's even true in other kinds of art. If you were a painter, you know, certain kinds of paintings might sell for $2 million and others won't. So you're maybe, that's part of your process. So poetry, I think, above all art forms, needs to be truthful. Because so much of our society is about lies, either absolute or the compromising of anything resembling truth and the kind of just slow corruption of it. Again, most of which happens due to market pressures. In the current day, we're seeing it through political pressures, but that's just another form of market. You know? I mean, like, to make money is the same as to win an election. It's a kind of goal-driven thing. I'll say this if that gets me the prize. Mm. You know, like that kind of corrupting of the real truth, the truthiness. What's that? That's that Colbert, right? Not truthiness. Anyway, and I think that. That's something you can't do in poetry. If you do, you're just making a mistake. If you're writing a sitcom, you should lie because that's what the market wants. If you're writing a poem, you just be true. Now, truth doesn't mean autobiographical truth necessarily. Mm-hmm. I mean, you get like a Toni Morrison thought. The impulse of the poem, if the impulse of the poem is, you know, social, then that needs to be true. If the impulse of the poem is purely language, then your attention to the language needs to be true. So again, poems can do so many different kinds of tasks or ideas. But whatever its nature is, its impulse, its goal, you have to be deeply true to your own artistic self in the expression thereof.
Mm-hmm. Or at least yourself then, at the time you're writing the
poem. You're absolutely right. No.
Which can change.
Truth is, yeah. Absolutely. Things we once wrote, we now look back and say, oh my God, I mean, you know, artistically I hate it, and I don't even know why I said that. I don't even believe those things. What happened?
Yeah.
So, but that's, it's all... You know, you go forward. It's all part of the same process. The first poem you write and the last poem you write are all connected. Or, as Galway Connell said, they're all just drafts until you die.
Oh, wow.
Only then do they become the final draft. We have, you know, a
lot
of...
Other questions from you all. Anything? Yes, in the back.
I just want to say that I really appreciated your reading of the poems. It was very eye-opening, and I also was transported, like I think you mentioned, into these images and into these frames and works of art that you were also mentioning there.
Thank you.
But my curiosity is, you also talked about you going through stages of your life where you have used different images or things that have happened to you. But now, what I want to know is, did you start writing with pencil or pen and paper, and now you're working, what is your medium now? Mm-hmm. Is it a computer? Mm-hmm. Is it, how do you express your immediacy when you have that urge to write, when we have computers and when we have all of these new technologies that we have today?
Everybody writer's practice is totally different, and you know, a lot of writers are kind of superstitious. They only do this way. It has to be this kind of pencil or whatever. I'm not too superstitious. But whatever works and gets you writing is important to work. I go back and forth between those two. I write, you know, I've always got a little notebook with me, and I have a journal, and I write most of my poems the original kernel of it is handwritten in some journal. Mm-hmm. Some thought, something I see, some perception gets written down. But after that first little, you know, maybe sometimes a lot of the poem, sometimes only a small piece, then most of the developing of that happens on a computer screen, and then I just constantly go back and forth. What I really like doing is I wrote something in my journal, and I'm gonna say, I'm gonna go type that up. And as I type it up, I can see more what have I actually got here? Is this really a thing or not? And then I print that out, and I write all over that. You know, and then the computer gives me this clean visualization of the poem, because there is a spatial aspect to poetry, you know, how it physically is in the page, and there's certainly a sonic aspect to it. And then I go back and forth. I print out a version, I write all over it, I incorporate those changes, and I keep going back and forth. So I'm a person who really goes back between the two. I think, you know, obviously the computer is an amazingly helpful tool to a writer. You know, the question is, I would feel very uncomfortable without that pen and paper. I mean, we're moving beyond, you know, printed matter and text of any sort, seemingly, to a complete, you know, the death of the book. All that stuff is, you know, they're not dying rapidly. They're very, it's a cheap and useful technology, book printing. It's not going to go away, but it's just being reduced to a minority part of the where words are written, where stories are absorbed, which is more in online formats and stuff. I don't know, poetry in a way, you know, predates all this stuff. Again, poetry not only predates novels and fiction, poetry predates literacy. Poetry predates written language. Before people had invented letters and alphabets, people were already speaking poems. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I feel like you have that, when you're writing a poem, you have that whole tradition behind you somewhere. You know, it's not like, it's unfortunately not like a helpful team of people to write the poem for you, but it is a real thing that you can actually feel empowered by if you kind of attend to it and believe in it.
Yeah, and that's so relevant to the kind of poetry you do because it did start as an oral tradition, and that's how history was passed, of course, down. Through the generations.
And that's, you know, I think a big central truth of poetry is that it needs to attend to that oral tradition, even though, again, our primary way of looking at poems reading is to read them on the page, even, mm-hmm. you know, as it is with everything. Mm-hmm. But poets who only, like those language poets are only basically thinking of their poems as text written on a page. They've forgotten about or abandoned the oral tradition that I think a poem is kind of three-dimensional. It might be interesting on the page, but hopefully it actually blossoms more fully when you hear it aloud. Mm-hmm. And when you hear it through time, it also makes poetry a time-based art, mm-hmm. which is very different, you know? I mean, paintings are static. That same painting, you can look at it forever in a novel, but a poem is really best understood as you experience it in real time, from its first word to its last, mm-hmm. sonically, and that's the experience. Then, of course, you go back to it and read it over and over, but that's kind of what is the unique part of poetry versus all the other literary forms.
Well, and yours does such a great job of combining the message and the music, and grounding it in that concrete imagery, which to me I think is the key, especially if you're writing long poems. I think it's really tough as readers to stick with long poems if you don't have the stuff of the world and you don't have the music embedded in some of that message. Any other questions in the back? Okay, I guess we have to wrap it up, but a big round of applause for Campbell McGrath. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Helen.
Again, look for his books. It has them online.
Look them in the bookstore, and you know, all my 10 books, well, 9 of my 10 books are available on Amazon if you want them. I didn't cart a whole box over. I didn't have it, so sorry to disappoint.
Yeah.
But again, the marketplace.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you all for coming. Thanks so much for being here.